Many of you asked me to talk about Seaspiracy, the new Netflix documentary on food and environment. It's been generating a lot of controversy, so let's take an objective look at it and see which claims stand up to scrutiny and which ones don't. By the way, what is up with that title? I know it's from the crowd that made Cowspiracy and they wanted it to sound similar, but Seaspiracy doesn't even make sense. It's not even a pun. You had so many options. The Secret, Fishy Business, Suspicious Activity, Hooked, A Time to Krill, Deceitful, Swindlers, Tied Up, or look, the most obvious one, Conspiracy. Come on. All right, let's do this. Let's take a look at Seaspiracy. The movie opens with a fast-paced montage of threats, guns, and car chases. Just so we know, it's a documentary, but it's not all gonna be boring facts. It's got some excitement. Then we meet our guide, the obligatory British narrator. Everybody knows you want to make a documentary, you need an English dude or Morgan Freeman. Non-negotiable. The first big question raised in Seaspiracy is about single-use plastics. Straws, plastic bags, packaging, etc. The movie argues that all the focus on reducing those on social media and in our society in general is a bit of a distraction, because the main source of plastic pollution is actually the fishing industry, with all their discarded nets and gear, and so the main solution would be to just eat less fish. So, is it true? Is fishing the main source of plastic pollution? And are straws just a straw man? According to this scientific publication, out of all the plastic in the ocean, 80% is from land sources, including plastic bags and other solid waste. As for the remaining 20%, commercial fishing is the major contributing human activity. Although in some areas, discarded fishing gear is particularly concentrated. The Great Pacific Garbage Patch is a vortex of plastic trash floating around in the Pacific, 3 times the size of France, and 46% of it is fishing nets. So the fishing industry does not cause most of the plastic pollution in the ocean, although it does cause a significant chunk, whereas straws are just 0.025% of the plastic dumped in the ocean. Although if we add all the plastic bottles, the plastic bags, the packaging, etc., that's a much bigger percentage. So my general impression is Seaspiracy is oversimplifying things a bit, but they do have a valid point that the fishing industry is a significant source of plastic pollution that doesn't get talked about nearly as much. Let's just agree they're both issues. Discarded fishing nets and all the single-use plastics. It's not like the environment is doing amazing. We need to minimize the damage any way we can. All right, moving on. Seaspiracy also tells us shark populations have sharply declined and are endangered. One problem being shark finning, the practice of cutting off the fins and discarding the rest of the animal back into the ocean, often still alive. Obviously, that's horrific. It happens because the fin is the most valuable part of the animal. Shark fin soup is very expensive in certain parts of Asia. The other big problem is bycatch, where animals that are not the primary target of fishermen get caught in the nets and are often discarded as waste. According to these scientists, since 1970, sharks and rays have declined by 71% because of an 18-fold increase in fishing pressure. And 3/4 of shark species are now at risk of extinction. And overfishing is the primary cause of marine defaunation, meaning loss of animal life. So sadly, the movie is right about that alarming decline in sharks. And Seaspiracy tells us it's not just sharks. Bycatch affects porpoises, dolphins, whales, seals, even seabirds. Another startling statistic in the movie is that out of 7 sea turtle species in existence, 6 are threatened or endangered. And the movie attributes this to fishing as well. Now, in general, those numbers do check out. 6 of the 7 sea turtle species are classified as threatened, endangered, or critically endangered. And it is largely due to human activity. And fishing does play a key role. Although it seems there are other factors as well. According to multiple experts, bycatch is one of the top threats. Although factors like coastal development, climate change, and pollution were also mentioned. And this was explicitly denied in the movie.
Not because of climate change, not because of ocean pollution.
So again, my general impression is they're making very valid points overall, although they tend to oversimplify things a bit. Now, in all fairness to the filmmakers, I know better than most people how hard it is to make content boiling down scientific concepts for a general audience. And at the end of the day, it's a movie. Yeah, it can help convey some important messages to the public, but hopefully we don't get most of our scientific information from Netflix. Bottom line, there are several big issues with human activity, but yes, fishing keeps coming up as a big problem for both pollution and loss of species. Next, the movie explains that one big problem with the fishing industry is the practice of trawling, where massive nets are dragged through the ocean, catching everything in their wake. Not surprisingly, trawling requires huge amounts of energy, causing as much carbon emission as airplanes. We'll touch on trawling again in a minute as it becomes relevant for our decisions. Next, Seaspiracy introduces us to some badass superstars. Sea Shepherd, an incredible organization that patrols the sea and just nails illegal fishing vessels. Apparently, they just roll up and ram and sink ships. They've sunk like a dozen. And then the movie goes back to talking about bycatch. Are you kidding me? Follow those dudes. That's your documentary right there. I want to see them ramming and sinking some ships. I would watch that all day long. And just look at their ship. How cool is that? I can see a reality show around these guys, Hollywood movie, a bunch of merch with Sea Shepherd on it. Fortunately, Seaspiracy does circle back later on and show us some Sea Shepherd action. Guns and night vision cameras and all. The movie also touches on food labels like Dolphin Safe. They score an interview with Santa Claus, who admits there's no way to guarantee a dolphin-safe product. And the documentary concludes the label is a bit of a sham. I didn't find that part that surprising, to be honest. We've seen this before with feel-good terms like cage-free or free-range. Usually, when we look into those, we find the conditions the animals are kept in are not much better. These large companies tend to just game the system and cut corners any way they can. It's just human nature. If there's an industry practice we don't like, the solution is almost never going to come from that same industry. Change can come through legislation, but we know how long that takes, or it can come from customers voting with our wallets. To the extent that people care about how animals are treated, the only options are A, raise the animal ourselves, B, buy from a local farm that we can visit and we know how the operation runs, or C, don't eat it. Those are pretty much the options right there. Delegating this work to large corporations and just hoping that they'll do what's right behind closed doors and just trusting these labels to give us peace of mind, that's always going to be, at best, a band-aid. Okay, moving on. Seaspiracy also shows us plenty of awkward interviews with organization reps squirming in their seats. This has become almost obligatory in these guerrilla documentaries. But you know you hit jackpot when they tell you to turn off the camera.
Can you turn off the cameras?
Because you know that's going in the trailer. And of course, they just keep recording. How does anyone still fall for this? Everybody knows these guys never turn off the cameras when you ask them to. It's like documentary film school 101. Just keep rolling. Now, some of these confrontation moments in the movie feel a little gimmicky. Like when they show up at the Mitsubishi headquarters without an appointment, no interview scheduled, and they just roll up with their cameras. Yeah, no wonder they ask you to leave. That's not exactly proof of a conspiracy. Or, sorry, a Seaspiracy. Next, the movie explains that oceans play a key role in fighting climate change. In fact, oceans pull as much carbon dioxide from the atmosphere as all the trees and plants on land. And that's only possible because of the activity and life cycle of all the animals in the ocean. Animals like turtles, seabirds, whales, dolphins, sharks, precisely the animals that are being decimated by human activity. No animals in the ocean, no carbon sequestration, and climate change skyrockets. So even if we only care about ourselves, just kill all the fish, who cares? It's in our own self-interest to not decimate marine life. Next, Seaspiracy touches on farmed fish, which has some advantages, at least at first glance, like avoiding bycatch. But with farmed animals, whether it's land or water, you always run into the same problems, like all the waste they produce that creates pollution. And what are you going to feed them? You can feed farmed fish other fish, but it becomes kind of a vicious cycle. Or you can feed them corn and soy, like cows and factory farms. Either way, you always need a ton of energy going into the system to generate all the food. This analysis looks at the environmental impact of different foods. Here's the greenhouse gas emissions for wild-caught fish without trawling. Here's with trawling. So, big effect, as we saw earlier. Now, here's farmed fish with and without water recirculation technology. And for reference, here's beef at one extreme, and then pork, chicken, dairy, eggs, and plants at the other extreme. So fish tends to be intermediate between pork and beef, on the higher end of greenhouse gas emissions. Now, maybe if they innovate in the future, farms can become greener, but right now it doesn't seem great. Seaspiracy also talks a lot about the idea of sustainable fishing, which is theoretically possible, just not at the current levels of consumption. We're overfishing and overconsuming globally, so at current levels, we're depleting the oceans and not putting enough back. So the opposite of sustainable. The film also touches on many other important issues like government subsidies or the horrific working conditions in the fishing industry, including, in some cases, slavery. The last segment of Seaspiracy looks at the health effects of eating fish. Honestly, I'm glad they put this section at the very end because, in my opinion, it's the weakest part of the documentary. Dr. Michael Greger comes on and says the only thing you'll miss from fish are the pollutants. Now, this is not about bashing Greger personally. For all we know, they shot for 2 hours and he contextualized a bunch, and those 10 seconds is all that made it into the movie. We know how that goes. But the fact is, the documentary does not represent the science on the health effects of eating fish. Fish consumption is largely linked to health benefits, including lower risk of cardiovascular disease, cancer, Alzheimer's, and overall mortality. In fact, the geographical regions where people eat the most fish and consequently the most contaminants from fish is also where we see the strongest link between fish consumption and health benefits. That's not to say that these contaminants like mercury don't matter. They do, and the type of fish and the amount of fish we eat makes a difference, especially in more sensitive groups like pregnant women or young children. But to suggest that fish is unhealthy, period, because it contains contaminants, is not an accurate representation of the evidence. I mean, it's not even close. And I say this as somebody who avoids fish and seafood, and not because of this documentary. I've avoided it for 10 years. The evidence indicates I could eat fish a couple times a week with no health issue. I avoid it because of the externalities, the environmental footprint, and I'd rather not pay somebody to go suffocate a fish if I don't need it. But that's just my personal choice. It doesn't mean we're going to make stuff up. Consuming fish, especially in moderate amounts, is largely linked to health benefits. Even when we compare fish to plant foods, we don't see a consistent winner. Some studies suggest an advantage of plants, but this large analysis published this year, for example, found no clear difference. Fish were generally linked to better health outcomes than red meat or eggs, but there was no significant difference between fish and legumes, nuts, or whole grains. And studies comparing vegans to pescatarians, like the Adventist Health Study, suggest some advantages for vegans, for example, when it comes to risk of diabetes and cancer, but when it comes to risk of overall death, it suggested a slight edge for pescatarians. And some of the healthiest and longest-lived populations, like the classical Okinawans, ate some fish. So it's just not clear either way, and to make this even less definitive, these studies only show correlations, so we have to take them with a grain of salt. Bottom line, the health data doesn't make a compelling case for pescatarians to eliminate fish, or for vegans to add it. Based on the available evidence, eating fish a couple times a week or not eating it at all are both compatible with health. And it's good to remember that for the vast majority of Westerners, if they replaced some of the other stuff they eat, including some of the other animal products, with some fish, that would be a big health improvement. Now, for those who choose not to eat fish, one common concern is the omega-3s, particularly the long-chain form, like EPA and DHA. Seaspiracy shows Dr. Clapper explaining algae are an effective source, and that's true. We actually covered this in more detail in a previous video. It's not entirely clear whether we need an external source of long-chain omega-3s, but in any case, algae supplements are as effective as fish oil and even fish itself. So any of the three will get you those omega-3s. Your call. My conclusion after watching Seaspiracy is I disagree with some of the points. Sometimes a little oversimplified, sometimes verging on misrepresentation, but they do a good job of shining the light on some of the issues with the fishing industry, like overfishing, which is a major issue for sea life and the environment in general. So I hope we can focus on the key takeaways and find solutions to minimize the damage and save our gorgeous oceans and sea life. They're probably going to keep making these movies, right? We're going to have Eggspiracy, Milkspiracy, Chickenspiracy. Someone on Twitter even asked them to make Beespiracy. Sure, make the movie, but please come up with a better name this time. Hey, here's some ideas. Feel free to use them. Buzzkill, The Honey Trap, The Sting, Betrayal, Shady Business, Plan B, Winging It, or my personal favorite, Dirty Politics. Hey, filmmakers, we got your back. If you want to see me fact check another Netflix documentary on food, click here. And for more on fish and omega-3s, check this one out. Actually, over here.